Hi everyone, I'm Vardha Sharma, editor Newsband, daily English newspaper of Navi Mumbai. As we all know, eucharmycosis, or the black fungus as it is popularly called, has emerged as an epidemic within the pandemic. To understand what this rare fungal infection is all about, its symptoms and its treatment, today we have with us a panel of leading doctors from MGM Hospital and Research Center, Navi Mumbai. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Dr. Sagar Sinha, who is the chief intensivist at MGM Hospital CBD. He is also in charge of management of COVID cases admitted in ICU in MGM Medical College, Navi Mumbai. He holds postgraduate degree in general medicine and also critical care from institutions in India and abroad. Welcome, Dr. Sinha.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Our next panelist is Dr. Ujwala Maheshwari, who is consultant pathologist at MGM Hospital and Research Center. She is also professor of pathology at MGM Medical College. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Our next panelist is Dr. Usha Asnani, who is professor at MGM Dental College, Navi Mumbai. She is also associated with MGM Hospital CBD Belapur as consultant. Welcome, Dr. Asnani.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Kalpana Kumar is a professor ENT department at MGM Medical College, and she's also consultant, ENT consultant at MGM Hospital CBD. Welcome, Dr. Kumar.
Thank you.
Dr. Vijay Mahadik, of course, is hospital director at MGM Hospital and Research Center CBD. Welcome, all the doctors.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Sinha, I will start with you first. If you can just let us know what exactly is meant by mucormycosis and why is it called black fungus?
Right. Thank you for having us. And it's important that I always keep telling that there are two pandemics. One is the actual pandemic and second is the information pandemic. So I appreciate the efforts of our organization to have this awareness session. And I think it's important that we understand the basics of any disease. So mucormycosis is actually a type of fungus which has been around for decades now. It's not a new disease. It's been around for many years, and it is a type of fungus which is usually seen in patients which we call are immunocompromised. Essentially, there are various type of microorganisms in the environment which can infect us. You can have bacteria, you can have viruses like COVID-19 or the common flu, and you can have fungi. So mucormycosis is a type of a fungus infection which generally infects the patients who have a weakened immune system. The weakened immune system can be because of an underlying problem, genetic problem, patients who are immunocompromised, and likely we see it in patients who have got cancer or whose immunity has gone down tremendously. And the black fungus is actually a partial misnomer because you have fungi which can be of various types and various nature. You can have white fungi, purple fungi, any type of colors possible, but that is largely dependent on the color of the fungus, what we see in the laboratory with the staining which we do. And secondly, is also the type of damage that fungus does to the tissues in the body. So it's not necessarily a black fungus, although it gets that name. It's a sort of a misnomer, but I think Maheshwari madam can clarify the misnomer between the color of the fungus and the type of damage it causes.
Another question associated with the same, as you said that are these fungal infection, fungal, the colors that we're talking about, are these also types of mucor infection?
So madam, fungi infection are usually of various types. Essentially, this is in fact a very uncommon fungus. The most common fungus, in fact, we eat it every day. Ultimately, things like, say, bread or beer, these are all basically a process of fermentation. So there are various types of processes. The most common fungus, in fact, is not mucormycosis, but is something which we call as candida. which is a much more common fungus and more commonly grown, which is yeast as such, as we like to call it. And the second most common type of medical fungus, which are dangerous, is what we call is Aspergillus, which is in fact the real black fungus originally. And mucormycosis is just another type of fungus. So fungi are of various types, and it is based on a particular definition which we use, which is a pathological definition, what we see, the type of disease it causes, a type of microbiological definition of what we see in the microscope, and obviously the disease manifestation is what we are really worried about.
Dr. Ujjwala Maheshwari, I would like to know, what are the various diagnostic tests available for mucor? And the RT-PCR test that we are doing, the swab test, COVID swab test, does that help in detecting mucor as well?
Thank you very much for taking us on the board. As I would say, the testing starts with the presentation of the patient. For example, if patient is presenting, as the clinician, Dr. Kalpana is there, Dr. Usha is there, they are seeing the patient, and when they suspect that this can be a mucormycosis, as a pathologist, we take the swab. Your first question was the RT-PCR for COVID-19 swab doesn't help in diagnosing this mucormycosis. But there is still a test available for mucormycosis, the PCR test. There also we take the swab, like the same swab we take for the COVID-19, and do the PCR testing. But besides these tests, there are other simpler tests available. And this is very expensive. This PCR test is very expensive. It's costing something around between 7 to 8K. But when we think about the economical options, which we are doing as a teamwork, as a KOH model, which is as soon as we take the sample from the patient, we put the KOH solution and a stain, and in 1 or 2 hours, we can see the fungus under the microscope. That is the first step we take. And after that, we have a colcofluor stain, which has to be seen under immunofluorescent microscope. In MGM hospital, we do have an immunofluorescence microscope. So, and we do testing with the colcofluor stain as well. Along with that, we put the culture on Saberoids media, which results minimum in 48 hours. And beautiful cotton wool. As your first question was, why it is called black fungus, and Dr. Sinha has already said it is a misnomer. But as a fungus, it looks beautiful, cotton wool, like you have kept the cotton in a tube. That is the way how the fungus looks like. And this is the way we diagnose. After doing the culture media, we take out the culture, part of the culture, and see under the microscope with the spatial stains. And depending on the morphology, we can diagnose whether it is a candida, or is it Aspergillus, or it is mucormycosis.
How long does it take for the reports to come out?
The first report comes out in 4 hours, that is KOH mount, and the second report comes after 48 hours.
48 hours. Dr. Usha, what are the various diagnostic and tests, or how can we detect rhinocerebral mucormycosis?
So, as we know, this is a very aggressively, rapidly growing disease. And nowadays, we have seen the increase in the incidence of this mucor, especially in the paranasal sinuses of the head and neck region, is of concern. And that too in the COVID-19 settings. It is associated with the morbidity and the mortality. It is very high. So it is very important. Rather, it is a key to success of the treatment is that we should have an early prevention. We should do the early diagnosis and the early treatment plan we have to initiate. So, first of all, as we said, the better awareness about the disease through the patients, into the patients and the family members is very, very important. So, because early diagnosis is going to definitely improve the outcome of the treatment. And this disease is associated with very much of morbidity, this thing rates. So many of the neurological complications also are associated. So these complications can be reduced. And recognition of the risk factors, as Dr. Sagar said, this disease is seen with the patients who are having the diabetes or other comorbidities. So if we identify these patients, so the consideration of the early interventions, we can start with these patients. And a very important thing, that is the assessment of the clinical sign symptoms, that is early sign and symptoms. For this patient needs to be under regular ENT, dental, ophthalm checkup. These early sign and symptoms are, we are giving as an list to the patient, and we are making patients whosoever are getting discharged from the hospital and their family members also, so that they should see the self-assess, they should self-assess themselves and come to the conclusion that whether they are having any risk factors, and they should seek the medical treatment at the earliest. And very important thing we can do is early referral for nasal endoscopy to the ENT surgeon, because these patients, although if don't have any sign and symptoms, if these patients whosoever have been discharged, if they are under the regular nasal endoscopic, we can find out the early progression of the disease. And of course, imaging modalities, as we know, MRI and CT are available for these patients. MRI can catch the early signs, and you know, this can see early changes in the bone marrow, early inflammatory changes in the soft tissue and the heart tissue. And of course, as Madam said, in 4 hours we can assess the disease through the microbial and the pathological image in this thing methods. So, but the gold standard is definitely the histological examination of the disease.
Dr. Kalpana, we get lots of cases of mucor in ear, nose, and throat. So, what are the symptoms? How can a person know if he's having a mucor mycosis?
It's basically known as a rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis. So usually this fungus spreads like that. It starts in the nose, then it spreads to the sinuses, from there to the orbit, that is the eye. And from the eye, from the optic nerve, it can spread into the intracranial cavity. So usually the early symptoms are always in the nose. So a patient will have unexplained nasal block, say unilateral on one side, unexplained reason of nasal blockage. Nasal discharge or occasionally blood stain. If he notices a lot of crust formation in a particular nose, especially black. So these are the symptoms in the nose. And then when it spreads to the sinuses, the patient will have swelling over the cheek or the face, numbness over the face, pain over the cheek. And then when it goes down into the oral cavity, the teeth may start getting loose, unexplained loosening, swelling over the palate, back discoloration over the palate. If it spreads up from this, goes to the eye, so then the patient can have pain or swelling around the eye, redness. The vision may get distorted, having double vision. Eventually, as a late symptom, the patient may even lose vision in one eye. So these are the early symptoms when it is in the nose, sinus, in the eye or in the oral cavity. Once it spreads into the brain, then the headache may start for the patient. So these are the warning symptoms of a patient with mucormycosis.
What needs to be done if there are symptoms, if there is a detection of the symptoms? So what will be the next stage of treatment?
The patient has to immediately consult his treating physician and explain to him the symptoms, and he wonders whether he's developed mucormycosis. And then they will be referred to an ENT surgeon. So we would do a thorough clinical examination and look for black crusts in the nose, a necrosed ball in the nasal cavity, and then it is sent for a microbiological examination to confirm that there is mucosis. Once that is confirmed that the tissue is mucor, then requires an MRI with contrast to know the extent of the disease. And most likely, depending on the extent, then we advise to the patient where the fungus has to be debrided. We have to remove the entire fungus from the nose, from the sinuses. And this can be done endoscopically, leaving no scar outside. Only if the skin is not involved. Once the skin is involved, then we may have to do an external approach of fungus. And it has reached the eye, then we can do an orbital clearance endoscopically of the fungus from the eye. But if the vision is lost and we need to do an orbital excinteration, it's called, then we may have to go ahead with that too. is lost and the fungal infection has reached the eye, so that the infection doesn't go into the brain through the optic nerve. And post-op, this patient will remain admitted for amphotericin B injection for at least 15 days. That the physician will be deciding the stipulated time he will require antifungal injections post-operative period. So he has to be admitted and his renal functions are monitored in the post-operative period. And finally, once he is clear, he's finished the dose, we'll be discharging him and we'll be giving him a good catalog on how to maintain his nasal hygiene. And of course, the blood sugar levels have to be maintained throughout. His diabetes has to be under control so that it doesn't flare up again. But the patient will have to follow for at least a period of 3 months post-operatively, say weekly and then maybe in 15 days, so that we can repeat endoscopy so that there's no recurrence of mucor, and if at all, then we can pick it up early in the course. So this is the symptoms and how we manage mucor mycosis.
Dr. Mahadik, how are mucor cases managed at your hospital so far?
So far, madam, we had one case. And this case was a charity case where all the treatment modalities which were required for the patient were provided by the hospital. The patient was admitted and had cross-references among various super specialists, various investigators. Whatever were required to be done, they had done. So what I can say that we have all the facilities available under one roof for the management of mucor.
Dr. Sinha, is it always the COVID patients who are at risk of developing or getting mucor mycosis? And how dangerous is mucor vis-a-vis COVID?
Right, Saman, that is the most important question, right? I mean, why is this there? Why is there now? Why are we talking about mucor mycosis in time of COVID? So mucor traditionally was seen in two types of patients. One was the patients who are essentially what we call solid organ transplant patients on immunosuppressants. So you have a patient with a kidney transplant who is on highly suppressive drugs. Those were the type of patients who usually used to get mucor mycosis. The second type of patients were the patients with active cancers. So essentially, it is the type of patients who have a very weak immune system. Now, what COVID-19 has done, the disease itself causes the immunity to go down. Secondly, the use of steroids and the excessive use of steroids and powerful immune drugs, they reduce the patient's immunity in the COVID and the post-COVID phase. Thirdly, patients who are diabetic and who have high sugars. So this creates a very nasty trifecta environment for patients to actually get. That is why we are seeing mucor mycosis in survivors of COVID. And not usually patients who have mild COVID, but basically patients who likely have been hospitalized due to COVID-19 and have diabetes, have been on oxygen and have received steroids or higher or powerful drugs. Now these patients have already fought a big battle. Now you have survivors of this COVID-19. And mucor mycosis, even in the pre-COVID era, the mortality is extremely high. Now, we know the COVID-19 numbers in India, the case fatality ratio is less than 1.7, 1.4%. That is the average number across the country. Mucor mycosis has a mortality of 50%. That means one out of every two patients untreated is going to die of the disease. So mucor mycosis is a very dangerous, very fatal disease if not caught in time. What Dr. Kalpana Madam mentioned, disease can start from here, go to the nose, go to the eye. But if it has gone to the brain, then that's very dangerous. So mucor mycosis is a very fatal disease. It's very important to pick it up before it invades into the system and becomes an invasive mucor which can't be treated medically and which has gone out of control where you can manage the disease where surgical also options are limited. So the key aspect of mucor mycosis is it's a very invasive disease. If you don't catch it early, then even surgery can be too little too late and the medical therapy also may not be able to save the patient in time. So that's something which is very important about mucor mycosis. Technically speaking, it is more dangerous than COVID-19 itself.
As Dr. Kalpana had said, that the symptoms usually it starts with the nasal. I mean, mucormycosis always starts with the nasal. So we have to be watchful with that.
So, madam, there are five types of mucormycosis. One is the rhinos orbitocerebral one, which is the one which we are seeing more of. But you also have other types of mucormycosis, which would be sometimes you can even have cutaneous, that means skin involvement. You can have secondary lung infection because of mucormycosis. You can have mucormycosis in the stomach as well. So there are the other types also of mucormycosis. But yes, what Dr. Kalpana madam mentioned, the rhino orbital cerebral one is the predominant, more common type of mucormycosis. And that is the type which we are seeing. Largely, it will involve symptoms in this area of the body. So essentially, whenever you have an unusual symptom involving your nose, your mouth, or your eye, or one part of the face, that could be the possibility where the patient should be screened for the possibility of mucormycosis.
Is surgical management the only way of the treatment? Or it can be treated medically or with medicines as well?
So ma'am, like I said, this has to be a combination of both the diseases. Both the therapies, because the disease is basically a disease which invades the tissues, and once the tissue dies, so the medical management, the amphotericin, is to prevent further spread of the disease. But if you don't take that dead tissue out, then in the rhino orbital cerebral mucormycosis (ROCM). You cannot just have medical management alone. You likely will have to have a possibility of surgical intervention. But there itself, it's very important to consult the ENT surgeon and or an OMFS specialist early on in the disease. So it cannot be just medical. The surgeon has to be involved early on. And that is more important than just the medical management.
Dr. Ujjwala, can black and other fungal infections occur simultaneously as well?
Yeah, sure. We can get mucormycosis along with other fungus like your diagnosed candida and aspergillosis as well.
And what are the other diseases that can also help, that can also result in the starting of mucor? Not only COVID, are there other diseases as well?
Dr. Sina has enumerated so many. Like, I'll just repeat the list. One is diabetes, wherever the sugar is high. The sugar is high not only because of diabetes. I'm not the actual specialist to speak on this, but still my knowledge is this. And the patient who are on cytotoxic drugs like cancer treatment, patient who have taken a radiotherapy, transplant patient which has been given an immunosuppressive therapy, these all cases wherever the patient's immunity is hampered, the mucormycosis or any other type of fungus or any other type of rare viruses do get in.
Dr. Mahadek, what are the challenges that hospitals are facing with regards to the treatment of mucor?
Very good question, madam. Thank you very much. Because hospital, more than the hospital, patients have lots of challenges. And because patients have to face those challenges, they are part of the hospital challenges. And one of the very important challenges is cost. Cost of the treatment is prohibitive. Perhaps you may like to know that liposomal amphotericin B, which is the mainstay drug for the treatment of mucormycosis, the vial may cost up to 5 to 7 thousand. And a patient may require at least 4 to 5 vials a day, as I'm told by my physician friends and other those working in the mucormycosis. So the cost can be prohibited. And then second important criteria of the challenge for the patient is long experience. Stay in the hospital for 2 to 3 weeks. So apart from the drugs, hospital stay. And as the Dr. Sagar Senna has mentioned, and my other colleagues have mentioned, a possibility of a surgery, it all becomes complicated. This is one of the big challenges in the management of mucormycosis, particularly in private hospitals. Now, I'm happy to inform that government has taken initiative. The patient can be treated in the private hospital. He can get his supply from NMMC. So, this is one relief that patient has at the moment. But if patient has to spend both for the drug and the surgery and his hospital stay, this is one big challenge. The second, another big challenge is for all the hospitals to evolve a policy with regard to the use of steroids. As Dr. Sagar Sinha has mentioned, Dr. Mahikari has also mentioned, that use of steroids leads to some immunosuppression, and diabetes, immunosuppression, that together can cause serious outcome for the patient. So hospital has to evolve a policy on the use of steroids without really in any way compromising the physician's authority. This is another challenge before most of the hospitals. Then third is the infection control. Most of these patients who develop pharmacosis, they are the ones who are generally immunocompromised. They are the one perhaps who had suffered from the COVID and post-COVID period, they suffer from this particular parasitic infection. So hospital control and prevention of hospital infection is a very important factor in the management of pharmacosis, particularly prevention. And that means that the staff have to be well trained. That means that we have to ensure that our staff are taking all precautionary measures. We have to ensure that patients are able to afford the cost of all those control measures, because they could be expensive. So these are some of the challenges, big challenges for a successful outcome of a patient in the hospital.
Dr. Asnani, you and your team have performed a few surgeries with regards to mucor. Can you just tell us, just in brief, any case study so that, the viewers are aware, what type of mucor mycosis can cause, what symptoms are there?
Yes, yes. We have come across many cases, and till now we have done 3 surgeries. So one case I can explain little. This patient was 47 years old, a male patient. From pain, he was reported, and he was having the COVID infection around 2 to 3 weeks back. He was a known case of diabetes. So his main complaint, first complaint, what was? It was an halitosis, bad breath. And he was having mobility of the teeth. These were the complaints. When we saw intraorally, we could see the pinpointed abscess from one side of canine, like one side on the left side canine to the other side premolar. And all the teeth were mobile. And along with those, the whole of the maxilla was shaking. So we took this patient after all baseline investigations were normal, then normalized, and then we took him for the surgery. And first Dr. Kalpana ENT, they cleaned the, they threw the endoscopic surgery. They went through the sinus and the ethmoid sinus, they cleared off those. And then later we removed the part of the maxilla along with the teeth. And our main aim was for this surgery was to create a healthy bed for the, as Dr. Sinha rightly said, that antifungal drugs, they have to reach the site. For that, we need to remove the dead tissue, dead soft and the bone tissue, which is necrosed. So we removed that. So we created the healthy bed for the infusion of the drug, rightly. So this was the case.
One question I would like to ask all the doctors, in fact, why, in fact, I think Dr. Sinha has already told, but in fact, I would like to ask again, why are we getting so many cases of mucor mycosis now? In fact, not even in the first wave, it is in the second wave that we are getting. And why is the concentration highest in India in comparison to the rest of the world? Dr. Sinha, I'll start with you.
So, ma'am, the jury is still out on that. And it's a little controversial because, today, I don't want to make any controversial points, but we have a new disease, COVID-19, yes. We have an old disease, mucor mycosis, yes. We understand mucor mycosis through the prism of our previous 30 years. If you look at the case reports of the 1,000 cases pre-2015, they will say, okay, mucor was caused because of 1, 2, and 3. And there, suddenly in COVID-19 in, say, India, now we have a sudden jump. We have about 8,000 cases in India, maybe 2,000 in Maharashtra. And if it comes down to the fact that, yes, COVID-19 itself could have caused the immunosuppression. Secondly, diabetes, yes, is more prevalent in India than what it was, say, 20 years back. But the excessive use of steroids and immunosuppressant drugs makes it a very controversial point, you know, because then that also puts an onus on the healthcare system, where probably some doctors went very over enthusiastic with the treatment of COVID-19 and maybe weren't able to control sugars as well or control diabetes as well. So I think the jury is still out on that. I think it's very difficult to attribute partially is the disease or this new surge in the second wave is some part of it to blame to man-made disease where, you know, doctors have used treatment. Patients also have medicated themselves at home this time, which wasn't the case. But yes, the answer still eludes us to a definitive point. And I wouldn't want to make any more controversial points because this is a news media platform. But I think I would welcome the inputs of my senior colleagues on this, absolutely.
Yes, Dr. Maheshwari, would you like to say something on this?
I'm not the proper person because I'm from diagnostic side.
Is it now that all of a sudden the cases are coming more?
That's true. Once in a while, we used to take the mucormycosis. But suddenly, in this second wave of COVID, we are seeing the more of the mucormycosis cases than the previous one. We do have seen the cases, but very rare. It was very, very rare for us to look into it. So major, whatever we are reading and listening to the clinicians is the major aim for whatever reason, the immunocompromised state. Is it a viral infection itself is giving or it is a treatment part it is giving? So we are really difficult. I'm in a difficult position to comment on.
Yes, and what is really surprising is the fact that why India? Why here that the numbers are more? Would you like to say, sir, Dr. Kalpana? Because ENT, I guess, they have many cases coming up, particularly during the second wave.
Okay, the patients who had followed up in our OPD with mycosis, they had suffered from COVID-19, but it was not during the second wave. They had all suffered COVID in the first. So I wouldn't say that these patients got it in the second wave and then presented with mucormycosis. So that is one. Second thing is basically mucor is causing ischemic necrosis. That means there is some thrombus or clot in the blood vessels which is causing disease in multiple. So possibly COVID is causing ischemic necrosis and then mucor which is abundant in the environment. So that is developing later in the patients who are immunocompromised as it is. It could be COVID itself is the reason for mucormycosis. And your third part of your question is why in India we are getting so much. So it's possible that we are getting over-the-counter drugs here. Many of the patients know the list of medicines given in the hospitals. So there's a lot of self-medication going on. A lot of general practitioners writing steroids and the patient takes it and doesn't follow. So we don't know for how long you're taking the same dose of steroid and not tapered the dose at home and not monitoring their blood sugar levels. So possibly it is that in follow-up, there was a lack in monitoring the blood sugar. They've been self-medicating on steroids. So these are the three reasons.
Basically, the underlying fact is that the sugar levels increase and that leads to my mucor. Is that the main crux?
It disposes to mucormycosis.
That spurts. And there are also, there have been certain studies or certain news which said that overdose of zinc and vitamin C that people are taking, is it also leading to mucor? Dr. Sinha?
So ma'am, the zinc hypothesis was proposed about 3 weeks back. Now, there is documented evidence that in the past, we never give iron treatment for patients, especially in the ICU, because that can promote fungal infections. In fact, one of the drugs which was used to remove iron was said to have, in one of the studies, increased the prevalence of mucormycosis. Now, that theory is quite interesting because there is a foundation of it proven in science regarding an iron chelating drug called desferrisox. But the link to zinc and vitamin C at this point is very purely speculative, and it's not proven, and there is no hypothesis which definitely concludes that zinc is linked to mucormycosis. There is definitely an association with specific iron and iron chelators. But ma'am, in general, coming to the basic point regarding zinc and vitamin C, the treatment of that is exactly why the COVID-19 treatment needs to be as simple as possible. And we shouldn't be giving any drug not necessary to the patient. And I would rather keep it as simple as that.
Thank you so much, all the doctors, for throwing us.
I just wanted to have a small discussion with Dr. Sagarsena. Sagarsena, in the first wave of COVID also, we had this COVID patients treated with steroids. But we didn't see much of, because we are maligning steroids a lot. But we didn't see during the first wave large number of, or rather, hardly any cases of mucormycosis. But this time, we have a feeling that steroids have a role to play. Oh, why this? Maybe one of the reasons for that I can think of and I can see that in the last pandemic, private practitioners were not involved in the treatment of COVID cases. And this time, a large number of private practitioners have been involved in the treatment of the COVID cases. And perhaps knowingly or unknowingly, they are using overdoses of steroids. And perhaps that is a contributing factor. Why is there this time you had a good number of mucormycosis cases? What's your view on that?
Yes, sir. I agree with you, sir. In fact, that's what even Kalpana ma'am mentioned, that this time, sir, that even the patients over the counter treatment of self, and sir, first wave of pandemic, it was only the large institutions which managed the disease, and it was left in the hands of specialized care, specialized institutions. And this time everybody got involved, and not just the general practitioner, even the non-MBBS streams. So basically, sir, that's right. This time it was very unregulated. And probably, sir, specialists and super specialists tend to be more careful with their practice. And many people were very enthusiastic in the treatment of COVID this time round, unlike the first wave. So definitely, sir, there is an X factor this time, and we haven't identified it fully. But like, it's very difficult to understand why first wave didn't have so much mucor, and why suddenly in the second wave we are having. So that remains to be seen, but that very well could be a likely factor.
Another thing, do you think our poor personal hygiene perhaps had role to play as well in addition?
Sir,
particularly because this time the disease even spread to the rural areas where personal hygiene is a big culprit. So maybe overuse of steroids, number one, complemented by poor personal hygiene. Could be the contributing factor for...
Sir, I think Dr. Usha ma'am can answer that probably. I think that she, because ma'am has a lot of with experience with the rural areas of Raigad, I think ma'am can tell us about the possibility about that.
Hospital setup, I don't think, sir, is a causative factor. But I think maybe, sir, the socioeconomic status of the patient is very important, and bad oral hygiene we can see, and if the delay in the diagnosis is there, I think so. So, Dr. Sagar, can it be the, if we are over-medicating ourselves with so many immunity booster drugs and zinc, vitamin C and this and that, is it like first wave we could not see and in the second wave?
Ma'am, there was something which Dr. Guleria, the AIIMS chief, had said all the way back in 2020 in the first month of the pandemic. And I cannot realize how true that statement was. It didn't strike me then. He said very clearly the only treatment for COVID-19, most important drug is oxygen. And ma'am, I can guarantee all of you that 1 year and 4 months later, that statement could not be more true. The most important treatment for COVID-19 for the 10% of patient, 5% of you require is just oxygen. And I think the way he identified that, it was really remarkable. Everything else in mild disease, there is no proven effect, nothing works. So oxygen being number one for the patients who are that sick. Number two, the enoxaparin, which is the blood thinning injection for select patients who are on oxygen. And number three, steroids in the right dose for those patients. And that is it. 1, 2, and 3. That is it. Remdesivir, again, for a small group. So I think, ma'am, that if we keep our treatment targeted and simple, we won't end up having to retrospectively think, you know, that was it because of this? Was it because of that? So I think what Dr. Guleria mentioned a year back is really remarkable. I mean, he was absolutely spot on with that treatment. So I think, ma'am, if we keep treatment simple, it really is the best thing we can do for the patient.
Yes. I think thank you so much, all the doctors. Yes, you would like to say something? Yes, Dr. Sinha?
Yeah. So the one of the key lines of the Hippocratic Oath, you know, is primum non nocere. I keep teaching my residents that. Basically, it means first do no harm. So...
Thanks a lot. I would like to thank all the panelists for giving us such insight into micromucosis. And the viewers, please stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.